arcade. And in fact, I am going. I'm going to come around everyone's house individually over the next 2 weeks, shake you by the hand and kiss you under the mistletoe. So you have been warned.
Every year, Windsor Television plays an important role in the Slough Town Show. This year, we sponsored the whole event.
Don't scream too loud or make any too many noises because they go bananas. We have the little one a bit near here and that one over there. Right, now, can you just move in here a little bit and tell us all about them? How old is this one?
About a year old.
It's about a year old. Isn't he beautiful? Absolutely gorgeous. Yeah, we'll try and turn him round in a minute, but he's getting excited. Look at that. I mean, that is just so special. Now, I mean, they are in danger in the wild, aren't they? What should we do to watch them but not sort of harm them? What should we do?
Well, the first thing, the most important thing, is if there are any wild animals around, is just be nice to animals, yeah? Humans are the worst enemies, yeah? Farmers have been ripping out hedgerows and going for intensive farming practices. And that has really done away with the prey for these. In the park here, we have wild rabbits running around. And the rabbits are one of the main sources of food for an animal like this. Myxomatosis got rid of an awful lot of the rabbits in the area. But they're slowly starting to come back again. And as they're coming back, so are the owls. And,
How old is this one?
It's about a year old.
A year old. And how big will he actually get?
This is full size.
That's full size, and that's a barn owl, is it?
This is in mating plumage now, ready to mate.
And tell us a little about one you've got over there, Nicky.
Well, with Connie over here, we've got a Bengal owl, is it? A Bengalese owl that was kept as a pet, but in fact it got too big for somebody to handle.
And
it was it was taken over to the Slough Owl Sanctuary down the road.
Right.
And she's now 3 years old. She's beautiful. She's just sitting here staring at us all.
Are you run on a charitable basis?
Yes, we're in the process of forming ourselves into a registered charity. Going through the paperwork and doing that now. The main thing that we've been doing at present is just trying to raise finances so that we can build the aviaries down at the sanctuary. That's been the hardest part of the problem so far, just letting people know what we're trying to do.
On June the 8th, we were at Bray Cricket Ground for David Essex's charity match. Not a ball was bowled because it was great weather for ducks. However, you know the British weather, and as the celebrities arrived along with a determined crowd, it became clear that the only item more useful than a cricket bat was an umbrella. Community singing of a selection of his hits. We Brits are made of stern stuff where our weather and sport is concerned, but the obvious thing to do now was to talk to all the celebrities in the VIP marquee. At least it was dry in there. Okay, with me now is the ambassador for this year for VSO. It's David Essex. David, welcome.
Thank you very much.
When did you take over the ambassadorship?
I think it was August of last year. VSO contacted me and asked me if I wanted to take over from Lord Litchfield, who was the previous ambassador. And although I thought it was a marvellous organisation, I didn't immediately say yes because I didn't want to be a sort of passive figurehead. So I came up with a scheme where, as I visited the projects in different developing world countries, that I would, in fact, recall musicians in those countries.
So what's next for Henry Kelly?
Well, Going for Gold will complete this current series in the next fortnight. We will almost certainly do a sixth series and a sports discussion programme, which I have down in HTV West in Bristol, called Extra Time, and which some of the people who are here today have appeared, Parky and Kenny Lynch, I see over there. It comes back in September. And other than that, I'm in for the job as a reporter on
Windsor Cable
Television, but I don't have the qualifications.
The job's yours, Henry. The money's lousy, but
I don't
the
have
yours.
The qualifications. Henry Kelly, News at 10, Windsor.
At the risk of embarrassing you, how long have you been in television?
35 years now, this year in fact, yeah. When I started, it was black and white.
This might go out in black and white. I shouldn't get too worried about it.
Back to my roots. Also, I mean, you didn't have anything either. Everything was live in those days, of course. It was great fun. I think the nice thing about those days was that nobody knew what to do. And the learning process was shared by everybody. And it was really great and spontaneous. It's a wonderful industry to be in. Today it's a lot different, much more technical, much more formalised. I think a bit of the spark's gone out of it.
Seems impossible that people would be skating on July the 25th. We're here in Black Park and it's now December. Remember the sign. But in July, we were at the Ice Gala. This is the Christmas flower display at J&A's flower stall in Windsor Station. Way back in summer, the flowers were blooming, the sun was blazing, and Nicky Reardon was talking to Major Ronald Ferguson.
Major Ferguson, I believe you've actually been involved in polo for 36 years now.
37.
And it's been said sustained enough injuries to merit a personal chapter in medical textbooks. Would you now admit that the game's quite dangerous?
I don't have to admit it. I've known it's dangerous from the very first day I played it. It is a dangerous game, of course it is, because if you bear in mind that horses are probably galloping about 30 miles an hour and you're allowed to ride into your opponent or give your opponent a bump, as we call it, not more than 45 degrees, it's savage. Equally, you're allowed to hook your opponent's stick if you can't get close enough to ride into him. And sometimes that stick, you misjudge your hook and it runs up your opponent's stick and hits you on the fingers and breaks your fingers and bruises your knuckles. It then can run up your arm, get in the area of your face, and these teeth are all screwed in and my nose has been flattened and there are cuts here and cuts there. It is a dangerous game, of course it is. And I always say to youngsters, if you don't want to be injured, don't start playing, because you will be injured sooner or later.
We'll be right back.
comes to our house, we can ask him.
Right. Will you see him?
He came last year. He might come today. I mean, on Christmas Day.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope he comes. We won't get your presents.
Yeah.
How does he get into your house?
Through the chimney.
Does he? How do you know? Do you see sooty footprints?
No.
No. I've never seen them either. Do you leave anything out for him?
Yeah.
What do you leave out?
A bottle of wine and some food.
You leave a whole bottle?
Sometimes. And then when we wake up, it's all gone.
Gosh.
Some of the most popular programmes we've made this year began right here on this bridge on August the 14th. The series, Here and Now. Seeing what's going on down by the river, and who do we bump into? But Mr. Mayor, that's your badger. How are
you? Hello, nice to meet
you. Nice to see you. What exactly are you doing here today?
Well, I am now demonstrating. Well, I'm asked to receive this new sweeper and launch it for the Royal Borough.
Right.
This is, we're going to have now real clean streets now under the new environment order that's gone out. We've got to, as you know, we're liable now for fines if we don't keep the borough clean. So the Royal Borough have gone right out now to get this, and this is what you call the real, this is the real McCoy.
The high-tech end of the market. It's a bright but very cold day, late December, and we're here again at Black Park. During the summer we came here, there was a heat wave, and we met some characters. Well, as well as Andrew catching his little tiddlers and gudgeons and all that sort of thing, we've got a serious fisherman here, all set up with two rods. What are you trying to catch today?
Pike. I'm catching after the big pike.
Your big pike?
Yes.
The great pike of Black Park.
Well, if you like, there's the best pike I've heard about in here was £30.
£30?
Yes. But for myself, I've caught one of £29.
That's still a big fish.
Oh, it's a big fish. It's over 3 foot in length.
And what sort of... how long does it take you to catch one that long, that length? I mean, once you've caught it, once it's actually on the line, how long does it take you to get it
in? Well,
they do struggle a bit, don't they?
They do. It took me about, let's say, between 10 to 12 minutes to play the fish,
right,
bring it and then net it.
There's a real art to fishing. I mean, we were talking to someone the other day about fishing, and he tells me that you've got to concentrate on the water temperature and where the fish are feeding and all this sort of
thing. Well, look, the likes of today, I think I'm wasting my time. There's too much
warm.
Sunshine.
Yeah, too much sunshine.
Yes, there is.
So can the fish see you?
Well, not with my bait, sir.
No, not that far out, no.
No.
How far out is your bait?
About 40 yards.
About 40 yards.
Yeah. Now, what I'm using for bait is mackerel.
Mackerel?
Yeah.
What a waste.
Well, no, listen.
No, I'm sure, but I just like mackerel, that's all.
So do I.
And so do the pike.
So do the pike.
Right.
The lake, sprat, mackerel, herring or sardine.
So literally it's the not the sprat to catch a mackerel, it's
no,
the
no,
mackerel,
it's a mackerel
to catch
a pike.
Pike.
Yeah. Yes, it is.
Prince's Run courses, you don't have to be a member. I'm not actually sure how much it is, but probably £40 or £50 for a morning, and you'd learn to ski in that time. This is my trick ski here.
All right, that's this one.
This is the one I was using before.
Here's one I prepared earlier.
Yeah. And the thing about this is it hasn't got any fins on the bottom, so right. It's like a tabletop and just turns around on the water.
So where does the traction and the movement come solely from your ankles and the way you move your feet?
Probably, yeah.
How easy is it to get injured?
Because it's so touch far. Wood.
Sorry, badly timed question, but...
Yeah. Not. It's a safe sport if you're taught properly and you do it properly.
If you keep your eyes horizontal and your head vertical, you'll keep good balance through the course. Even when you lean over, just keep your head vertical.
How long's the rope now, Jodie?
It's 16 metres.
And that's how much shorter than she was originally?
Well, the original rope is 60 feet, which is 18 and a quarter metres.
Right.
And it's the maximum length for slalom ski.
Right. How difficult is that for somebody, obviously, who's only 11 years old on Sunday?
Well, that is quite difficult. She just run the lady's maximum speed, which is 34 miles an hour, and then the rope starts to shorten from there on.
Right. And there she is. Now we're doing a run towards the clubhouse now, and as you can see, Lisa's going at a hell of a speed and leaning right over at right angles to the water. And as she goes around each buoy, she takes one hand off the rope, and it really is spectacular. And with me now is the then just Lisa Adams. Hello, Lisa.
Hello.
And you're now European slalom junior ski champion.
Yes.
Tell me about your trip to Italy.
It went very well, had a nice flight, and when I got to Italy, I managed to win the preliminary round of the slalom, and I also managed to win the final event, and so I won that, but I didn't do very well in the tricks.
Okay, so what went wrong in the tricks?
I did my first run very well with my 22nd pass, but on my second run, I didn't do so well because I fell early.
Oh dear. And the team, I believe, overall, how did they do? They did quite well, didn't they?
Yeah, they came second overall, which wasn't too bad. I think Gary Shipman, who's the manager of the Water Sports Centre, he was pleased.
Right, good. But how many other gold medals were won by the team?
I think I was the only person who won the gold medal, but we had quite a lot of second and thirds that were won. So.
But you won the gold, as predicted, on this very programme. Now then, what are you going to be doing over Christmas? Are you still water skiing, even though it's freezing cold?
Yeah, I've been going up to Nottingham every weekend and having training with Alexander Mininock, and he's a very good coach because he can trick about 10,000 points, so he's really good.
Good stuff. And what are you going to be doing over Christmas? You're going to have a little break and get stuck into all the food?
Yeah, I think I've got about two more weekends until I break for Christmas, and then I think I've got a few days in December.
Right, and 4 weeks off school too.
Yeah.
Are you looking forward to it?
Yes.
On September the 6th, I had the privilege to visit Harefield Hospital with Here and Now. We met some extraordinary people. How did the problems with your heart manifest themselves, and how long ago?
I can really trace it back to just before Christmas, when the work as a clergyman was beginning to pile on before Christmas time. And uncharacteristically for me, I began to feel tired. And I couldn't understand why after my lunch I wanted to sleep. Very shortly after breakfast I wanted to sleep. Walking was becoming very, very difficult. I was tremendously short of breath, even though prior to Christmas I would have been playing squash twice a week at a very competitive level. Walking was always a great pastime. Gardening was a pastime. Swimming was always a weekly event in my calendar as well. So I was fit, I thought, and all of a sudden here I was experiencing all these symptoms. And then I just thought I had some form of cold, consulted my GP, and he initially started a series of tests, then I began in after Christmas to feel little palpitations of the heart, and I went to see my GP again, who did a cardiac reading and noticed a little irregular heartbeat and put me in contact with a very good cardiologist in Belfast, Dr. Jerry Murta, who has taken great care of me. And he diagnosed very, very quickly that I had cardiomyopathy, and within a few days, in the beginning of March, explained to me that my only hope was to have a complete heart transplantation.
Right, you actually had the operation on Friday, is that right?
That's correct, yes.
And how are you feeling now, that 6 days later you look in remarkable health?
I feel great. I'd love to go outside and to take a walk in the sunshine and do all the things that I wasn't able to do 6 days ago before I had it, the transplant. I feel good. I look forward to full recovery and full fitness and getting back to the old squash. Maybe not within the next 6 weeks, but...
And maybe not with the same tenacity, just for a little while. But
I can put up with that. You know, the quality of life in 6 days, my words cannot describe what a change the heart transplant has meant to me.
One of the busiest and most well-known venues for music in Windsor is the Old Trout behind me. And during the course of the year, Sam Cherry went to see the Drowning Room play live and talk to them.
What influences? I mean, I know this is a very sort of like narrow question, and maybe bands don't like to answer questions like this, but what actually inspired you?
I don't know, I mean, well, I don't know what individually, if you're asking, I mean, you can ask us each in turn, like me. I mean, the reason I want to be in the band is for the live performance, like the aggression and, I don't know, sort of action, not just sort of writing songs for the pub. Purpose of that, you know, because I mean, I think quite a lot of people can do that, but I'm sort of doing it just for, you know, try and put some, like I say, aggression in the music and make it a good show for people to come and see.
Yeah.
As opposed to just going there, playing your songs and going off home.
To actually create a feeling, I mean, I know a lot of today's music is very sort of lethargic, uh-huh. And maybe have lost the sort of like, yeah. The yesterday's sort of like... Yeah, it's very much a blend, very samey. Yeah, so you're trying to create something a bit more exciting.
Yeah, like the 60s.
I think energy is the key word. We're trying to sort of push the energy out.
Yeah.
And sort of spark some emotion, really. Rather than just saying, oh yeah, it's another band, you want somebody to come up and say, yeah, that's pretty good.
Trip, trip like a broken tire. Black cat raps on the mat. I wanna sing with the angel choir. Come on, baby, set this house on fire.
Box, 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 box.
Till the end of time.
Box, 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 box.
My poor lady, yeah.
Box, 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 box.
I wanna marry you. Sing to me, baby.
Balloons in Uxbridge. There were balloons in Hayes of a very different kind. We went up in one and met some more extraordinary people at the third European heart transplant games at Hayes Stadium in September. Someone landed.
It's Sunday the 8th of September and we're at the heart transplant games. It's the third European games at Hayes Stadium. Well, we've not only joined the third European transplant games, Pam, but we've seem to have been transplanted from the Earth.
Yes, we have rather, haven't we? It's a
pleasant way to spend
here,
the
yes.
Sunday, isn't it? Can you tell me your basic function at Harefield?
I organise transplants when we are notified of donors throughout the UK or Europe. And with the help of the doctors, we decide which patient we're going to call in. We get contact that patient. We organise all the departments necessary to be present at the operation. And I organise transport for the team to go out to wherever we have to retrieve a heart from. And I also accompany the team as coordinator to keep in touch with Harefield.
So it's not strictly a 9-to-5 job at all?
No, definitely not.
Once you've got obviously a computer list of all your potential recipients.
Yes.
What is the average sort of weight? I mean, for example, it might be January they go on the list, they're notified that they need an operation.
Sadly, with such a long waiting list, because we're the biggest unit in the world, it's around 21 months at the moment for a heart. People waiting for a heart lung have to wait probably about 18 months, and those for a single lung probably about 7 or 8 months.
We were at the hospital and we met some fascinating people, including, of course, Professor Yaku, but we met some of the patients and they said that there's no pain associated with it. What's the most painful bit for you?
Oh, I don't know. It's knowing that somebody else has died, I think, to make these operations worthwhile. But we do know from, although I don't deal with the families of these donors, we do know that those families gain a lot of benefit from knowing that family member hasn't died in vain, that other people can benefit from that death.
We all realise that when a death occurs, it's a horrible word, it's a nasty thing to think about, but it is a fact of life that death does come. But when people allow bodies to be destroyed in some form or another, they must also realise that they are destroying the possibility of saving somebody else's life. I know it is a very, very difficult decision to make. It strikes at religious feelings, ethics and anything else. This is a personal thing to each and every one of us. But I would like to say, if they thought very strongly and carefully about this, everybody that's involved with somebody within their family that most unfortunately has to die, they are also holding the possibility of saving somebody's life, or at least improving the quality of life.
...1991 is the year of sport, the British Sports Council. And people all over the country have been encouraged to make the most of sport. I don't know where I've ever seen it exemplified better than with these extraordinary people from all over the world making the most of sport at the third European Heart Transplant Games.
Me, they very kindly agreed to allow me to have their daughter's organ. I will be forever grateful to those people. I've never met them, they've never met me, but I would like to say thank you so very much, and on behalf of all transplants, whether it be kidney, whether it be heart, lung, whether it be cornea, pancreas, liver, it doesn't matter. Those people that make a donation of that magnitude is making somebody else have either A, a life, or B, certainly a better life than they would have had otherwise.
It's a pretty bleak and cold day here in Alexandra Gardens today. And it was pretty cold the morning we got up very early to join the Windsor Lions on their fun run.
a hell of a lot. But nobody's blue is brighter than the blue of my baby tonight. A man is a snake in the island. Baby do is making a wretch. A man is a dog in the jungle. His heart is an empty fridge.
Unfortunately, are the Trevelyan Terrors.
Yay!
And their names are
Natasha Adams,
Zoe Robson,
Charlotte Hudson,
Margaret Milan,
Anna McCulloch,
Zoe Virgo.
Absolutely marvellous. And these three have got freckles painted on. Who did these for you?
Me!
Me!
She's the shy, retiring one of the group. And your freckles. You've got the built-in in sort of suntan. You've got a magnificent colour. What on earth have you got freckles painted on your face for?
I don't know. She wanted them painted on.
To make you look more terrifying.
Yeah. We just wanted it based on school and stuff.
Because all the cheeky girls and naughty girls and terrors and all that always have freckles. And they're all pretty. They look all pretty. And they're really, really nasty.
And we've got one here, or two here, actually, without freckles, and our Zoe on the end, who didn't have to paint any on whatsoever, because she's got her own. How many have you got, Zoe? Have you counted them?
No.
No? Well, anyway, thank you very much, Trevelyan Terrors. Did you all finish the race?
Yeah.
I ran it twice.
Who ran it twice?
I did.
Why?
I ran it once for my family and once for the school.
Oh, the terrible McCullochs.
Yeah.
Oh dear, we're in serious trouble with the McCullochs. Thank you very much indeed, Trevelyan Terrors. See you next year.
Yeah.
the chief supporter over there, just in that flowery stuff over there. She's our chief supporter.
We'll see if we can get over there and talk to her in a moment. Oh, this is Katrina, who didn't want to be on television, but now you are, Katrina. So give him a wave. That's marvellous. From the Trevelyan Terrors and me, cheerio for now. Concorde, the finest aircraft in the world. And some of the finest entertainment this year has been provided by you during our Entertainer of the Year competition. Let's go to Slough and Maidenhead. Thank you. Can we count on you for a bit of singing going on?
Sorry.
Why is that? Can't you sing?
Not today.
Tell me you don't sing in the bar.
I don't sing, no.
I don't believe you. Would you sing if Jonathan sings with you?
I'll sing if they sing.
Your friends, the ones who are running away. The ones I'm going to chase after and see if we can get hold of. Now, your friend says that if you sing, she'll sing.
Yeah? Well, I might do.
All right, we'd hope to see you on the stage later.
Yeah.
Right, we're going to have a little run round here past the Cable Bear to the registration desk to see who's signing up to sing for the competition. The real serious singers are here. The real serious air. Janet, how's the registration going? You got plenty of volunteers?
Wonderful.
Wonderful. You got lots of volunteers. How many people have signed up so far?
About 18.
About 18. That's terrific already. We've only been here about half an hour. Let's talk to these two. Now, we've just seen this lady up on stage singing Fame.
Yeah.
Well, it's not nerve-wracking, is it?
I'm still shaking. I couldn't write my name.
Well, that's excitement. That's not
yeah, that's what it is. It's
nerves.
Excitement.
What's your name?
Rebecca.
Rebecca, and you're going to enter the competition.
Yeah.
Have you entered, have
yeah,
you?
I've just done it.
Well, we hope to see you at the final, and we might see you on stage a little bit later, yeah?
Yeah.
Good, great, well done. Welcome back.
Hello there, Max.
Hi, Dennis.
Hello.
How are you? Nice to see you again.
Okay, now before we do something, let me just say, you're not professional singers, are you?
No.
An electrician, and what do you do?
A domestic housewife.
A domestic housewife, as opposed to an industrial housewife, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. Right. Dennis and Max, and what are you going to do? On my own. They're going to do On My Own together. Here they are. Big round of applause, please. A bit of support for Dennis and Max.
Go for it, you two.
Greatest love of all.
stage, what makes it all sound so brilliant is Uncle Joe and Uncle Clint. Clint.
Hi.
Hiya, how's it going?
Not too bad.
This is what it's all about. Joe can explain it all to us. What makes it all work then, Joe?
Well, actually, as long as we've got enough food in our stomachs and enough money in our pockets, it all comes together.
So it's nice here today, under the trees, in the sunshine, Jonathan Ross and
the whole... new talent in Maidenhead is absolutely sensational.
It's sensational, in fact.
It's worth getting out of bed to just come and hear all these new budding artists just doing their stuff.
All right, thanks a lot, Joe.
Do you like looking at each other's presents?
Yeah. Sometimes we try and guess what's in our stockings.
Do you ever know?
Sometimes we get them right.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes we don't get them right.
One of the most enjoyable days out with Here and Now this year was in October when we came here to the Edwardian International Hotel. Here we experienced the very best in cuisine and some of the warmest hospitality. Obviously, one hotel bedroom in the Edwardian is pretty much like another, John. This one, however, is very, very different.
It is, indeed, yes.
This is the presidential suite.
That's right. Shall we go through
it? Yeah, please.
After you.
Thank you. Oh, look, there's Ronnie Reagan. Sorry.
On his own, also.
On his own.
This is a presidential suite. The hotel in total has got 17 suites. Now, I will say before we begin that all the rooms in the hotel have exactly the same decor
right.
In terms of the furnishings and the fittings. However, the suites, of course, are that little bit larger with the separate dining area. And if you look around the room, you'll notice, the hand-woven carpets from Thailand and, of course, the cedar wood panelling, which is very traditional and it creates that country house blend.
Yeah, it's a very, very intimate feel about it. Yet you realise, of course, that because of the facilities like excellent room service and very high standard of cuisine, that you are in an international hotel.
Yes. We've got to be able to cater for both the business traveller and the person on leisure travelling
right.
overnight, and of course the residential conference delegate.
And among your recent guests, you have actually had a former president of the United States.
Oh, yes, the news creeps out quickly, doesn't it? Yes, we have, yes.
And that was?
Mr. Carter.
Didn't bring his peanuts with him, did he?
No, he didn't. He left those.
Let's have a look around the rest of the room.
Good.
Some of the other features of it are the beautiful marquetry work that is featured on the wardrobes, etc.
Yes, I mean, as we get closer to them, you'll notice that everything is hand painted on them.
Four poster bed.
Again, very romantic. Although, saying that, it's quite unique. A lot of the individual business people on their own don't mind them. They quite enjoy staying in them. One would think they're just exclusively for the honeymoon couple, which of course they are, primarily for the summer months, of which they do very well. Your televisions are all neatly fitted inside. And of course, the televisions itself have all the European channels, also the arrival and departure flight times, which again is important when you're staying at Heathrow.
That's very, very helpful. Each telephone has its own answering, private answer service, does it not?
Yes. You can have a message, your own message personally. You leave your own personal message on the phone, and of course you get your message verbally.
There are lovely facilities like the standard letter paper, etc., which is not really done in a typical hotel style, is it? Pretty much like everything else at the Edwardian that you've...
Well, what we pride ourselves very much on is that the personal touch, very, very much the attention to detail. And if you look, as you say, everything, it's very much the small detail. And people, at the end of the day, do notice that, and that's what they're paying the extra few pounds for.
You mentioned, or it was mentioned earlier, I think Mr. Tobish told us, that there are over 6 football pitches of Sicilian marble in the
that's
hotel.
Great.
And most of it's in the bathroom.
Shall we have a look?
Yeah, let's do that. Well, it's almost as big as a football pitch in here.
Well, you can fit, I think, 10 people in the showers.
That's tremendous. It makes you want to dive in there. I mean, normally a shower is something you want to get in and out of pretty quickly, but I must say you could certainly spend serious time in there, couldn't you?
And of course the shades of the marble changes throughout the rooms, and of course throughout the suites. You have a peach shade in other rooms, and of course a black marble in parts of the other suites. Again, it's the attention to detail. You notice in the spa bath, fitted with digital clocks.
You've got a digital
check, that's right. You've got your digital
thermometer check.
Right, so you can check how long you've actually soaking away in there.
That is absolutely tremendous, and it's a lovely theme throughout the hotel. Lovely attention to detail, and makes you feel very at home. Because hotels are, especially for the businessman, if you're travelling away from home quite a bit, is something that really is not a very... People think it's a very glamorous thing to do, stay in hotels, but you do get bored with it, don't you?
Very much so, and what Edwardian offers at the end of the day is very much that different experience. It's something new, something unique, and it's definitely something very new to the area.
We met plenty of celebrities throughout the year. They're all very different, but none of them are more different than this man.
crowd behind me is one of the Dennis fire engines with the London Fire Brigade. And in November, we went to Langley to see them in action.
For the sake of authenticity, some volunteers act as though in severe pain. The treatment, however, is very real. It is necessary to use dummies like these to simulate the most seriously injured and possible fatalities. Objectives for the firefighting team include evacuation of the main building and rescuing victims trapped in a maintenance area below ground. Observers discuss the options with an officer at the scene.
What is it?
It's deadly stuff down there, I don't know.
You don't know what it is?
We wear protection up when we go down.
What, full protection?
Yeah.
Normally like we do.
Yeah, suits and stuff.
Suits and stuff and everything. Yeah. So you don't know what's in there?
No.
Are you in charge of it?
Well, no, I've worked with it.
How many people in there?
I think there's probably two in there.
How many were working there?
I think there were only two. They
and how far down does the pick go?
It's about 20 feet.
And what sort of work were they doing in there?
Maintenance work, electric motors and stuff.
Electric motors?
Yeah.
So there's about three in there?
No, it's two, I think.
Two?
I think
and whereabouts
well, you
down the bottom?
You'll see them, because they'll be in... It's all pipes and motors, but it doesn't go anywhere. It's just a pit.
Just a pit?
Yeah.
OK.
Watch the big step there. Boy. I'm out now, mate. Is it taking you now?
Yeah.
Peter, do me a little job, will you?
Senior fire officers and other observers monitor the progress of the rescue attempt for the people trapped below ground. Christmas is a time for children, and we went to see some unfortunate children who've got to spend Christmas in hospital at Ashford in Middlesex.
Happy Christmas.
Okay, and why are you in here?
Well, because I got knocked out playing rugby.
Yes, you told me about that earlier, didn't you? Are you going to play again?
Yep.
Are you sure?
Yep.
Is your mum going to let you?
I don't know, I hope so.
So what happened to you? Did you get concussed?
Yeah.
Yeah, and how did you feel?
Weird.
Father Christmas is over in the corner. Let's go and have a chat to him. Hello,
Hello.
Father Christmas. Nice to meet you.
Yes.
How are you?
Oh, very well indeed. Enjoyed my journey from Lapland. Had a marvellous time.
Is it the first time you've been out there?
Yes, it's the first time.
I was actually quite curious. Where have you parked the sleigh? Is it on the roof?
It's on the roof, up just above here.
Did you come down through the chimney?
Yes, I came down through the chimney. I'm all hot and sweaty coming down there. It was warm down there.
You're not covered in much soot.
No, there was no soot there. It was just heat. Really hot, you see. It was lovely. Rudolph is up there, waiting to go. He's waiting for the dark to come, so his red nose radio can look around and see everybody.
I'm with Ray Whitney, our chairman. Hello.
Hello.
And I believe you're responsible for part of this party.
Well, thanks to the Windsor Cable team. I help them, but they do the work, and we always have great fun at hospitals at Christmas.
Okay, and why did you decide to put on the party here?
Well, we always like to do what we can for children, and of course Christmas is a special time for them, and in fact it's part of what we do always for the community.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
Happy Christmas, everybody.
Just like any other day at our Price Video here in Slough, really, and goodness
downtown
me.
Slough, yeah. I've been here a couple of times in the last few weeks. I'm becoming a Slough addict. Yeah.
You're not working behind the counter today, though. You're here to launch your new video, aren't you?
Yeah, this thing. The new video.
I've got one of those.
And it's, but yours has got a red label on. Mine's got a green label.
And yours hasn't got a tape in it, and mine has.
Oh, well, that's what's different about it. All right, then you win. Right. I hate you.
So when did it all start, the Paul Daniels magic show?
Very long time ago, you know.
Yes, I know. I think I watched it myself.
I went through a lot of wigs. I remember.
There's one on the screen now, actually.
Yes.
Here's one I prepared earlier.
Yes, there's the vanishing wig up there, yes. With Penelope Keith, yeah, she was nice.
And the famous Through the Glass trick.
No, I did, I've done about 200 shows, I think, for the BBC and ITV altogether. And so what happened was a company called Watershed came along and said, what about the best ofs? Because we, over the years, you keep getting these letters, it would be great to see this again, or it's great to see that again. And I gave that over to a guy called Barry Murray, who wrote Whizbit, the children's series. And I said, hey, I can't pick this stuff out, you pick it out. So he picked it out. And it was good, yeah, it's all right. I watched it the other day, you know. Fooled myself. I couldn't understand it, yes.
Some of these are your own personal favourites. Any that went wrong?
No, tricks don't really kind of go wrong to that extent. Things like, not on the video, but we did one time with two barrels, one on top of the other. One's full of water, and Martin gets in the top and comes out of the bottom barrel, but no water. So how does he get from there to there and not transfer the water? And it was stood in the studio all day with the studio lights on. And, of course, studio lights are very hot, right, as you know, dear boy, in the world of television. Yeah. And what happened was the plank shrunk, and up came this guy, you know, and he'll forgive me if I say he minced a little. And he got this bucket of water, and he poured it in this thing, whole studio full of electrics, and it just gushed out all over the place. And he went, ooh, I'm leaking. So I didn't mind, really. Then the water swelled it, and it was okay after that.
You've been pretty good as a parent, really. I mean, Martin's been thrown through fire and dunked in water, and you've done it all to him. None of it yourself, I noticed.
No. Well, that's what children are for, you know. Mm. Yes, he keeps fawning Esther Ranson. Doesn't do him any good. Every time he's on the show, on the next series, I promise you, he doesn't get hurt. He does two illusions all by himself, very modern style illusions, and in a, you know, he's a modern guy, and so that's the area he will start to do in the show.
Impossible question, really, but have you got a favourite stunt that you've pulled?
No, not really. I suppose I enjoyed doing Penelope Keith through the glass because she didn't know how it was done, and that's how I prefer it. I don't like actresses and actors coming on the show and saying, and now, Paul, there are no camera tricks, and it's all sort of pedantic. If you watch the video, you'll see she's totally natural because she doesn't know what's going to happen next, and I prefer that. I think that's a good idea. The big illusion on the end of the video is the biggest illusion ever done in Europe, I think. It's weighed in at 50 tons, I think. Lots of falling concrete and all that, you know. But also, what's interesting is that the very first thing they show is the very first little teaser trick that we did yonks back, which has just been invented again by a chap at the Magic Circle, which I found very interesting that he would invent this trick I'd already performed 12 years ago. Mm.
Some of those are huge illusions and need great big sets and that sort of thing. Can you show us one now on the table in front of you?
Well,
something small and sort of homely.
You're talking about me again, aren't you?
No, I'm not. No.
Well, I'll show you one.
The cards are out.
You'll have to be very quick to see this. Here, just say stop when I do this.
Stop.
See what I mean?
You have to be quicker than
quicker
that.
Than
yeah.
There you go.
Stop.
All right. That's whatever that is your card. Okay. You agree with that?
Yeah? I agree with that.
All right. Now I square the cards up. All right. But your card isn't sneaked to the bottom. All right. As far as I know, it's not on the top. It's somewhere in there. Now, you have to tell me what was your card, because I don't know.
King of Diamonds.
King of Diamonds. All right. I'll drop the cards on the table, okay? I tell you that so he'll be ready. All right. I'm going to drop the cards on the table. King of Diamonds. There you go. Finds itself. This is a trained deck.
This trained desk, as far as I'm concerned, I couldn't see it.
No, this is a our price, just a standard table. Yes. He's looking underneath it for trapdoors. How silly you are. Yeah.
So, you've done just about everything there is to do in magic, and of course you've got a fantastic successful series with Every Second Counts. What's next for Paul Daniels?
Well, I'm already, as you quite rightly say, a sex symbol. Thimble? I'm currently writing, I know this sounds mad, but all at the same time I'm writing 23 books, 10 of which will be for general sale to the public, and they have to be written as a series. 13 will only be for magicians, on how I did all of these things and why, which is very important to a performer. Then I'm also putting out a book of posters. I've got a vast collection of magic, and I'm trying to buy the Shepherd's Bush Empire to convert it into a magical theatre. I've got I'm making some videos of how to do magic. They say they might release another one of these, and I've got Every Second Counts to record, and I've got another series. We're writing the next series of magic. No wonder I'm tired.
So that takes us up to Friday. What are you doing next week?
Don't. That's what Debbie says.
Oh, right. Yes. The wife.
The wife, who's on her way back from Spain at the moment, yeah.
Who, in your opinion, is the best magician, apart from yourself, obviously, when you're looking in the mirror doing the tricks? Who's the best magician you've ever seen?
Ever seen is difficult, because they all do different things, you know. I get paid to do the full gamut, but most guys specialise. I like the Lance Burton and the Harry Blackstone stage shows. Johnny Paul, who recently died, was a very, very entertaining close-up worker, you know, in Las Vegas. Siegfried and Roy, for sheer spectacle on the stage, is the biggest magic show I think I will ever see. A guy called Ken Brooks, long time dead now, who was extremely entertaining for magicians, a magician's magician, you know, that kind of thing. So all of those. If I had to pick somebody in this country now who I would say, hey, he does it well on TV and all that, people think it's kind of, I don't know, it's weird that I say Martin, but Martin has, over the years, learned to relax. He's not me, he's his own man. He's not quite as good looking, sad that. But he is a good television presenter performer, and I'm very proud of that.
Runs in the family, obviously.
I don't know.
I'm sure he'd say the same about you if he was standing here. What are you going to do for Christmas this year?
The Christmas show will be very different. I like to make Christmas shows that are different. Last year I played all the guest artists in prosthetic makeup. This year it's more of a musical. I don't like television shows that say this is the so-and-so Christmas special and it's got a Christmas tree stuck in the corner. I really do like to make a special show. So that's that. Although the family will just all come together at Christmas and we'll just spend Christmas round the fire. I've got an oak-beamed house with open fireplaces and all that. Martin will be up in Ashton under Lyne, so we'll all go up and see him in the pantomime. And then New Year is a bit sad because I was going to be in the Kremlin and it's fallen through in this new financial crisis they've had. I was booked to be in the Presidential Theatre of the Kremlin and it went phew. It's a bit shame, isn't it?
But
it
means such is life. Paul Daniels, wish you a Merry Christmas and thanks for talking to us.
And to you too. Have a happy Christmas and a very happy New Year.
Well, that's almost it for this year's Christmas episode. And none of the programmes we've made this year would have been made without your cooperation. That's the viewer, the people in Windsor, Slough, Staines and Maidenhead. We hope that you've enjoyed the programmes we've made this year. And from me to you, a very happy Christmas.
So this is Christmas. And what have you done? Another year over. Just begun, and so this is Christmas. I hope you have fun. The near and the dear ones, the old and the young. A very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
When you walk the country's wildest mountains, you learn how to keep warm. It can be much more difficult as you get older or less mobile, but there are things you can do. Wrap up well, especially outdoors. Several thin layers are much better than one thick layer, and natural fibers generally keep you warmer. Exercise keeps muscles supple and the circulation flowing, so keep active. Move about as much as possible. Traditional hot meals and plenty of hot drinks will make you feel warmer inside. And make sure the area you spend most time in is snug and cozy. At the end of the day, stay warm in bed with plenty of blankets and a hot water bottle. Old-fashioned bed socks and a hat should keep you comfortable. For more information, ring 0800 289 404 free. Keep warm, keep well this winter.
Have you ever wondered what children do after school or what they'd like to do?
Usually watch telly, play
on my computer and die every 5 seconds.
Watch television.
I go home and play with all my Lego and watch telly.
Yeah, and we go to Watford Leisure Centre on Thursday, me and him.
Play football.
Yeah, see some of the Watford players, Darren Baisley and David James. They're good. Love playing football there.
Yeah, I go swimming about 5 times a week. We have relays. We have to do butterfly.
At the beginning of 1991, a new initiative, Champion Coaching, was launched. The National Coaching Foundation developed this project to provide children like these with after-school sport opportunities. We asked Mr. Robert Atkins why he chose to invest $700,000 in this way.
We thought there was a need for an examination of a scheme that's been in the mind of the National Coaching Foundation for some time. And we wanted to see how it worked around and about. And so I found about £750,000, and we've set up a number of pilot schemes around the country in every one of the English regions. And it's going to give an opportunity for about 6,000 youngsters to get specialised coaching at three different levels, and at the same time to leave behind some newly trained coaches to carry on the good work.
Windsor and Maidenhead's plan for the future development of after-school sport was a contributory factor in its selection as one of 24 schemes across the country. The sports initially chosen for the project included badminton, cricket, swimming, netball, soccer, tennis, basketball, rugby league, rugby union, table tennis and hockey. Katie Donovan explains why these sports were chosen.
Basically, we knew we were dealing with traditional after-school sport problems, so we chose a variety of sports to include some team sports, some individual sports, swimming, etc., so that we could look across the board at a number of issues that would apply to all the after-school sports in England.
Opportunities in badminton, soccer, netball, tennis and rugby were provided for the children in Windsor and Maidenhead. Often good ideas are simple in theory but take a lot of hard work to put into practice. The man behind this project is Sean Kearns. What is Champion Coach's biggest success in this area?
The coaches, without a shadow of a doubt. They've been absolutely brilliant. They put in their own time to make sure that the initiative is followed through and that the quality sessions that we're about is being provided.
How have you ensured that quality has happened in the first year?
I'd have to say that the bottom line quality for Champion Coaching has been the selection, the recruitment, training and nominations of our head coaches. We have 136 head coaches that have been approved both by the local scheme and the national governing body, and those folks have then gone through a rigorous training schedule. So on the ground floor, our coaches are our key to quality control.
We asked the coaches about the training provided by the Champion Coaching Project.
Well, we had a training weekend at Crystal Palace, which was great fun, actually, because it enabled us to meet coaches from other sports and with a vast wealth of experience. So it was really lovely to gain from their experience, to talk on a social basis, but also about coaching in general. So on a personal level, I found that very rewarding and stimulating.
I attended the Loughborough training weekend, which I found very useful. It was like going back to college and meeting all the people that you'd read the books about or had written the books, and then you actually got to meet them. So it was very good.
On the course we learnt all about child psychology, child development, how to coach mixed groups of children.
Weekend was interesting, listening to other people from other sports talk and relating what they get out of their sport and what we may get out of them for ours.
Although we deal with children a lot in coaching, a course I hadn't done specifically, so I thought that was very good.
I think the biggest thing the children have got from it is understanding the discipline that's involved in playing. It's not just techniques, it's the attitude, it's being on time, it's being clean boots, ready to play. It's all the little things that are socially very valuable.
When the children arrived, obviously we weren't sure what standard they were going to be. In fact, they are a mixed ability at the moment. The advantage of that for us is that we have three or four coaches working with the children, so I was able to segregate them into specific groups depending on their ability. In terms of a progression, by the end of the course, they will all be able to play a game of doubles and a game of singles, understanding the rules and the basic shots.
It's been a great improvement, particularly in the children that haven't done any sport, any rugby before. The girls in particular have improved dramatically. They started off absolutely terrified of the ball. Every time we went to throw it to them, they were very scared of it. And now they're playing competently. They're even tackling today and kicking today. So there's been a great improvement there.
Don't think this is another project for just the elite few. It's a national scheme which, in its first year, has already enabled many thousands of children to work toward their own goals, whether that be competing for their school team, swimming to save a life, or playing a new sport. In the past, sporting heroes provided fine examples of both technique and sportsmanship. However, nowadays they often display less than exemplary behaviour.
We haven't had any tantrums. Racket throwing was rife about 3 or 4 years ago during the McEnroe era, and it's very difficult to dissuade them to do that if they're seeing it on television.
It's important to actually go for the ball, but not if you're taking out an opponent. You know, it's not winning at all costs. It's winning is nice, but you know, we've got to be clean but mean at the same time.
Has anyone talked to you about fair play?
Yes, lots of times. All of us are trying to get the fair play award.
The fair play that has come out of it, again, is really a spin-off. It's a nice spin-off. Now, Nick was our winner here. If he knew if the ball hit him, it went out, he would go and get the ball, give it back, and then we'd condition the others to wait for him because he was good enough to get the ball for them.
We decided that the person who turned up regularly, who dealt with all of the tasks that we set and came out with answers to the questions we ask, the young girl, Katrina, was the girl we chose for all of the reasons that we chose.
I've won the award for fair play, which is what this jump is all about. We mustn't, if someone says it's off and someone else says it's on to protect their game, you must always be say the true answer, not just to protect yourself. That's what I always thought about it.
Reynolds acknowledges the importance of quality coaching. Is there any one way you think the coach has really helped you personally?
I think myself as well as the whole of the England team when we were kind of not as fit as the rest of the world, and the athletics coaches that took us through that period was really good, and now there's kind of a lot more fitness as well as stamina and strength work, weight work done in rugby, which is good news.
There are three main rugby clubs in this area that we're going to encourage the children to go to. Windsor, obviously, because we're based here, Maidenhead and Slough. I've actually prepared a leaflet for the children with all the names and addresses of the youth officials of the clubs. We're going to give those to them today.
Because of the resource, we've been able to channel different people into different courses. I think maybe in the future we could sift them a little bit so that we have different ability groups within the system that's working at the moment.
So if you had the chance to see something else happen, what would happen next? In my mind, I think we need to pick the schemes that have done the very, very best. So there'd be a vetting process there. I think we would expand the number of sports that we have to include some non-traditional sports now, outdoor activities, more individual sports, etc. I think we're ready to include that variable now. The other thing is, I think instead of having just one term's worth of offerings, we'd spread that out over the school year so that we'd have a 6 to 8 week block possibly in each of the three school terms.
Okay, and how would you implement all that?
We'd use the same schemes that we have now, the ones that made the grades, so to speak, and we would upgrade the kinds of things that we started in phase one. More training of the scheme liaison officer, our on-the-ground right-hand person. More parent education, expanded training for assistant coaches. We would begin to build in these variables a little bit better.
Certainly on the preliminary results that we're having, it's turning out to be such a success that I have hopes of being able to extend it next time. But the reports that I'm getting are that youngsters are taking up these opportunities to such a great extent that it far exceeds the demand, or the demand far exceeds the supply. And therefore, clearly, the lesson that we get from that is that there's a very real need for this sort of coaching, and we're going to have to try and deliver it in the future.
These children have obviously gained a great deal from champion coaching. How can other children and parents become involved if they want to join the project?
We're quite keen that any child that's interested should have the ability to join in, and we'd be quite keen for them to contact us. The sessions in these five sports that we've currently been running, obviously we'll be continuing them. We'll also be looking to run other sporting sessions, so if they are interested, just give me a call.
Oh, me who's killing time. Lay down old dreams and things once remembered. It's just the same, these miss you again. But these mission lights are the longest.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
After all these
Jim Lee.
And then what does he do?
He gives the presents in the, he puts the presents in the bag, he sorts them out, and then he goes down and has the milk and the pie.
We're now going live on Radio 1. Follow me around here. You can see the excitement at the front of the hall. What about a big Maidenhead thank you to Liz Kershaw and Gary Davis.
Thank you. See you again soon sometime. Thank you.
We're all looking forward to having lots of fun over Christmas. Let's look back at March the 15th at the fun we had on Red Nose Day. Family School in Langley. It's a long time since it's not that long since I was at school, but let's go and see what they're teaching their children on March the 15th.
Okay, come on, Christian, you're going to teach the children how to do the stomp, aren't you? Go on, children, watch Christian, they're going to do it with you. Come on,
to then? No answer. Aren't you all supposed to be in bed or something?
No.
Why are you all in your pyjamas then?
Because it's Red Nose Day.
It's Red Nose. It's not, is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh. No, my nose always looks like that. What are you all doing? Are you raising money for Comic Relief?
Yeah.
What are we doing for the rest of the day?
Stalking!
We're here to gunk you.
Yes.
What have you done to deserve this, John?
Well, I'm not quite sure. You should really ask the people here.
Do we want him gunked?
Yes!
All of it or half of it?
All of it!
And another one?
I think the truth of the matter is that I give these people such a hard time during the year. It's only right and proper they should give me a hard time occasionally. And furthermore, they've raised all this money for Red Nose Appeal, so the least I can do is stand under and get a little bit wet. Nice! Oh, look at
down
that!
Down the neck!
Oh! You'd be amazed what I can see in here!
Don't worry, John, only another 20 minutes to go.
Oh, really? Oh.
I think it'll help a lot if you open your T-shirt, John, and let it down the neck.
After you!
No, after you! No, I can't. I'm in this official shirt. Pull it open, John. Pull your neck. That's it. Don't breathe in.
Oh! It's quite nice,
say
really.
When.
It's quite nice, really. Is that it?
It really was a lot of fun, and we look forward to the next Red Nose Day and all those crazy antics. On April the 23rd, Windsor had a very important visitor indeed. Some people who were unable to be here early enough to line the perimeter route at Home Park lined the streets of Windsor Town Centre. Her Majesty the Queen made the short journey from the castle to Home Park for the ceremony. Mr. Wałęsa and his entourage flew in from Poland this morning and, having been greeted by dignitaries and representatives of Her Majesty the Queen, was driven in a state Rolls-Royce of the Queen's fleet from Heathrow Airport to this picturesque riverside setting. Assembled in Home Park is a guard of honour found by the 2nd Battalion Grenadier Guards with the Queen's company colour, the Royal Standard of the Regiment, the Band of the Regiment, and the Corps of Drums of the Battalion under the command of Major Edward Bolotho. Fortunately, the weather's been kind to us, and the sunshine and warm temperatures have allowed the use of the open state carriages. And in the first one that leaves Home Park is Her Majesty the Queen accompanying Mr. Lech Wałęsa. In the second carriage with the magnificent horse procession is His Royal Highness the Duke of Edinburgh and Mrs. Danuta Wałęsa, obviously enjoying the occasion. Following behind in these magnificent state carriages are various officials from Poland, the Secretary of State for the President's office, religious leaders, and their escorts representing Her Majesty the Queen from this country. The sky today is cloudy and grey, and it's very cold. On May the 9th, it was warm, the sky was blue, and balloons were flying over Hatfield House.
walking sticks are actually probably the first tool used by man, in that I guarantee that when man went from four limbs onto two legs, I bet you used a stick. It goes all the way back. For example, in Tutankhamun's tomb, they found over 300 walking sticks. The heyday of walking sticks was the latter part of the last century, going up to about 1920. But then the walking stick, the use of it died out, because what were you going to do with a walking stick in a baby Austin? Until then, every self-respecting man went out with his hat, coat, and cane. The two rules when you're making a stick are that the material must be right for the job. So resin castings are out because they'll chip. You've got to use sound wood. And the second rule is it must be comfortable in the hand, so that if you're doing a carving of an Alsatian head, for example, you can only put that onto a tall stick and hold it by the neck, because the pricked ears make it impossible for it to be used on a 3-foot stick, which is the hip length stick. The materials used for making walking sticks are all natural materials, and actually it only recently occurred to me that we're in the recycling business.
One way and another, we've spent quite a lot of time near the water this year, and on May the 19th we visited the canal side at the turning point in Cowley in Middlesex to visit the angling fair.
Arcade, and in fact I'm going to come around everyone's house individually over the next 2 weeks, shake you by the hand and kiss you under the mistletoe, so you have been warned.
Every year, Windsor Television plays an important role in the Slough Town Show. This year, we sponsored the whole event.
Oh,